Black Leather Jackets plays out like one of Rod Serling's subpar sci-fi driven scripts, but it was actually written by Earl Hamner. His next installment to air after the fun You Drive, what made Hamner say this about his own episode?
Let's touch on Black Leather Jackets.
That was the bad one.
Three young men wearing matching clothes ride into a small town on motorcycles. They rent out a house in the suburbs and quickly catch the eye of their new neighbors, the Tillmans. Inside the mostly empty house, the trio, named Scott, Steve, and Fred, exhibit telekinetic powers and plot something in secret. After the Tillman's power starts going in and out, the man of the house, Stu, walks over to question them upon seeing a new antenna on the trio's roof. He's pushed around until Steve alters his memory of the interaction and the older man leaves. Stu's daughter Ellen is attracted to the youngest of the group, Scott, and the pair start to hit it off. Scott eventually falls for Tillman, angering his brothers, who question if he's still loyal to their mission. The smitten visitor now must either follow through with the original plan or warn Ellen of what's on its way. By his own admission, the biggest issue here is definitely Hamner's script.
If the words are not there, if it isn't good, the actors and the director can just do so much. So they did what they could with a bad script.
I'm inclined to agree. I don't know what he was going for outside of a very basic Is Humanity Worth Saving story. It's not a spoiler that these three leather-bound bad boys aren't what they seem, so why do they choose to take this appearance and move to a place where they'll obviously stick out? It's said later they've studied society extensively and they mention there's no good to be found among people since we all treat each other so poorly. Maybe they're just imitating that? By being high school bullies?
We are monsters, Daddy-O.
We came from outer space.
Take us to your leader.
Cool it, Daddy-O, or I'll disintegrate you with my ray gun.
The most interesting detail about Hamner's writing process was that he named Scott, Steve, and Fred after his son and his neighborhood friends who'd constantly get into trouble. Earl had a pair of installments left, so we'll see how he finished up his time inside the zone very soon. Director Joseph M. Newman was coming off of a couple good showings, with In Praise of Pip and The Last Night of a Jockey earlier in the season. He would also have one more opportunity at helming a zone with the final installment to air, Hamner's The Bewitchin' Pool. The low quality of his third effort wasn't his fault. You can see how he tried to give this story some visual pop, as there were some nice looking shots and sequences in it. However, like Earl said, you could only do so much with a bad script. That sentiment extends to the acting. The only returning zone player in Black Leather Jackets was Wayne Heffley in an uncredited role as one of the movers toward the beginning of the show. Everyone's fine on screen, no one has an abysmal performance or anything. If anyone maximized their minutes to their fullest extent though, I'd give credit to Michael Forrest as Steve. His character was at least somewhat intimidating, and he had a cool look.
You're making a mistake, Scott. These people aren't worth it.
Scott dashes to Ellen's, trying to warn her of the coming invasion and genocide of the human race.
We have had bacteria units in every country on this planet for months. Each unit has enough germs to poison the drinking supply of the entire world population.
The new trio on the block are among thousands of alien beings who have already invaded the world's infrastructure. They plan on carrying out a scheme to repopulate the Earth with their own kind once humans are out of the way. Ellen thinks Scott is mentally ill, and even though she loves him...
Scott, please, I love you, but you're not well.
Yep, loves him. She tells her father, who calls the local sheriff's deputy. Little does Stu know, Deputy Harper is actually another alien. Scott fails to convince his people's leader to spare the Earth, and Harper soon arrives at the Tillmans with orderlies who have the young extraterrestrial hauled away. Scott's ravings fall on deaf ears as the invasion and full-on extermination of mankind begin.
Most of these people have the capacity for love, I know it.
They are a world of angry, frightened people.
They learn love from their God and teach it to their children. There's more of love here than hate.
They want to hammer home that Scott feels love and receives love from Ellen, but they aren't given enough time to develop that relationship, and the well-intended message falls flat. The inconsistencies stack up near the end as Scott again tries to convince Ellen he's telling the truth, but won't prove it by showing off his telekinetic powers. Maybe he was too afraid with Sheriff Skinsuit in the same room, I don't know. Bottom line, skip it. Black Leather Jackets needed a new wardrobe. There's other, more appealing apparel to try on, and the changing rooms of the Twilight Zone. Yeah, that's the best I got today.
Forget it.